Feliz Año Nuevo, Happy New Year. So we are the ones who decided to stay home for New Year's and take a nap before the countdown. We spent a quiet evening at home with just me and Hector and the sermon. So that's what we did. That was our New Year's. And so we binge-watched Netflix and ate food. So it was a good time. We really enjoyed it. Well, I'm sure all of us are quite excited to have our Christmas shopping done and over with. I don't know if you made sure you got everyone's gift and it was exactly what they needed, or you just did the other thing and just got everybody a gift card. But we're certainly glad that we're done with Christmas shopping. And in our family, we really love a good deal. I don't know if you like a good deal. One of my favorite kinds of deals is a BOGO, the buy one, get one. My husband says it's not really a deal, but I like to think it is because you get two things for one. And so as a gift to First Christian Church of Selma, we decided to give a BOGO of our own. So I invited a co-preacher with me this morning, all the way from Fresno, California. I was on a tight budget, but I managed to do it. Mr. Hector Hernandez. And he's alive. He has acute bronchitis, but it's okay. We made it, honey. We made it. He's okay. So, hi.
Thanks for inviting me.
You're welcome. Again, I was on a short budget, so I was like, oh, I could do this. So we're going to be tag-teaming this sermon throughout this morning. We hope it's a first for us, but we thought it's a new year. Let's try a new thing. But sometimes two voices are better than one. Most of the time, two voices are better than one. It was sort of serendipitous that it was two people presiding and two people preaching. So I'm going to let you start this one off.
Go ahead.
Yes, tag.
So, speaking of Christmas, earlier in December, we were faced with a decision. If you know my son Isaac, he is a huge basketball fanatic. His favorite player is Derrick Rose. And so when Derrick Rose was traded from the Chicago Bulls to the New York Knicks, he even switched his team because he wanted to follow Derrick Rose. So anyways, he approached me and he asked if he can go to the New York Knicks basketball game, the one where they were playing the Los Angeles Lakers, the team that I love. It was my favorite team. And in all honesty, it wasn't in our plans, it wasn't in our budget, it wasn't even on the radar. And if you know me, certain people like to call me cheap. Or frugal. I like to use the words wise, smart. But it costed money and time. And so we processed it, we thought about it, we got permission. And with the help of our parents, my mom and Cindy's mom, we were able to make the trip. We bought tickets that were a little higher in price, and we went for it. It was a decision that we made, it was a sacrifice that we did for Isaac. Now, if it was anybody else, it would have been a hard no. Don't even think about it, right? But it was for our son, and so we made that sacrifice. And so, speaking of sacrifices, it's one of the things that we see throughout Scripture and in this text, and so Cindy and I are going to talk a little bit more about sacrifice. And before we go there, she's going to give us an introduction, an overview of what's going on in this text.
I couldn't preach a sermon without giving you some history. For all of you who know that, I'm a historian. That's my background. Suffice to say, Isaac really enjoyed his Christmas gift. I don't know if we set up an expectation, but it probably will never happen again. but he was really, really excited for that trip, and it was memorable for him, and so we're really glad to do it. But again, the things that we do for our children or our grandchildren, I don't know if you can relate to that, but sometimes maybe you do a little extra than you would normally do for anybody else, and so that was our little extra. So here we find ourselves in this space in Hebrews, and I want you to imagine with me, if you would, a place where you feel the most welcome. Like, this is a place where you feel right at home. Maybe everybody knows your name. Most of you live in Selma, and so maybe that's Selma, or for some of you it's this church, or maybe it's another space. But you feel the most comfortable there. You're at home. People know who you are. It's this loving feeling that you feel whenever you're there. Okay, have you imagined your place? Okay. Now imagine that from one day to the next, that place is no longer safe for you. It's no longer a welcoming space. It's no longer loving. In fact, you're considered an enemy if you enter into that space. And the only way that you can feel welcome again is if you conform. If you conform to a belief or to a system in which you disagree with. That doesn't bring up happy feelings, right? This place that was your place that you loved, and now all of a sudden it becomes a place where you're unwelcome. Well, during this time, Christians were being persecuted, hunted down for their beliefs. Those Jewish Christians, this letter is being written to Jewish Christians during a time where they're being persecuted. And they're being persecuted on two ends. They're being persecuted by the Jews who had not considered Jesus the Messiah. They did not believe that Jesus was the one who was coming to liberate them. The Pharisees and the Sadducees were part of that group. And so they felt pressure from this group, but they also felt pressure from the Roman Emperor, who, if you know anything about Rome, was one of the most ruthless empires that ever existed. And part of it was that Jewish Christians would not pay tribute to Rome, so taxes. We all know about taxes. We're going to have to pay them soon, or we have paid them. And so here we have this group of people that is in the midst of persecution. They're no longer feeling at home or comfortable in their space. Because they're being persecuted, and this letter is being written to them. This is a beautiful letter. In fact, it's considered some of the most beautiful parts of Scripture, the letter of Hebrews. We're not really sure who wrote it. Some consider Paul, others say someone else. But it was written to the Hebrews, to Jewish Christians who were being persecuted, who were feeling a little bit out of place, to say. I don't know if you can kind of imagine what that might feel like. And so here we have this letter that reminds them of who Christ is, reminds them that Christ had entered into their space, become like them, incarnate, we just celebrated Jesus' birth, had become like them, had endured all that they had, all that it means to be human, every kind of temptation and trial, and now, and not only that, but he also conquered the fear of death. And I can imagine as a Christian being persecuted that it would be quite comforting to me to hear that the Jesus that I'm serving had conquered death if I could literally see the possibility of death. Right? I'm being persecuted. Death is a very viable option that may happen to me. And so here we have, not the most cheery passage to like think through on a New Year's, we're not always wanting to think through some of this passage, because part of it is suffering, that as these Christians are being persecuted, they have to endure suffering, and yet here Jesus is saying, I will stand in solidarity with you through that suffering, and so this is kind of smack in the middle of where we find ourselves in this text.
The more I think about it and reflect, I do think. Suffering, I can't help but to think that it's part of our Christian walk. It's part of our journey as people of faith. When we think about the life of Christ and how he suffered, not only at the end of his life, but since the beginning. As an early child, him and his family had to relocate several times because they were threatened to be threatened by being killed. They had to uproot and relocate. You know, as we think about him growing up, right, he suffered the death of his buddy, his pal Lazarus, and he cried, right? He suffered rejection by his own disciples when it came time to stand with him, so to speak. They abandoned him and they left him. He suffered even rejection. And so even we see it in at the end of his life, when he was crucified, when he was beaten and whipped and verbally abused and all of that, he suffered much. And so as I think about suffering, it is at some point part of our lives. Sometimes we don't choose it, right? Sometimes tragedy happens and it just comes upon us and we suffer. Or there's other times we bring it upon ourselves. So a number of years ago, when I was 16, 17, I used to graffiti. I used to tag. And I got caught for it. And I was put on house arrest for 6 months. I had to wear the ankle monitor, and for me, I suffered. I was at home, I couldn't go to the movies, I couldn't go to my friend's house, I couldn't do anything other than go to school or to church on Sunday. And for me, that was suffering. That's not the suffering I'm talking about here. I brought that suffering on myself, so to speak. The suffering I'm talking about is the self-sacrificial suffering that we see in the life of Christ. And we can also see it in others as well. So go with me for a second here, and let's think about Rosa Parks. Rosa Parks was an African-American activist in the time of the Civil Rights Movement. And she had made a decision at one point in her life to not get up and not give up her seat for another, which caused a lot of suffering on her end, right? She lost her job because of it as a seamstress. She was threatened several times, like countless times, life-threatening calls because of it. But the interesting thing about that was it was planned out. She knew what she was getting herself into. When they boycotted during that time, when they boycotted the buses, they planned, okay, they said, who has jobs? And who's going to need to get to work who normally rides the bus? And let's find ways for them to get to work without using the bus before they even boycotted. They were planning it out. Or when they committed an act that was going to get them arrested or that threatened them with arrest, okay, do you have children? Who's going to take care of your children when you go to jail? You know, so it was planned out. They knew very well that the things they were going to do can cause suffering and persecution in different ways, and they were willing to take those stands and do those things. This is the type of suffering that Cindy and I are talking about today, the type of suffering that involves sometimes choice to stand with and for others.
We should have given a disclaimer that this isn't going to be a very chipper sermon. I mean, I don't know about you, but I don't know that I would just want to like sign up as a follower of Jesus if I knew I was going to suffer. Am I the only one who'd be willing to admit that? And yet, that's exactly what we're called to do, to stand in and with and for others. And the beauty and the good news of this text is found in verse 14, which is just 14 and 15, the most powerful parts of this text, and I want to encourage you to follow along in verse 14. Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity, so that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is, the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by the fear of death. Yeah, that is just a good word. I think that word can preach all on its own. But here, the good news of this text is not only, yes, not all of us want to suffer. I mean, I don't want to suffer. But yet, it is part of our Christian walk. And the kind of suffering that Hector was mentioning is his self-sacrificial suffering. And there's also another form of suffering, right? There's often times when things happen in our lives in which we encounter suffering. And it wasn't preordained. So suffering is not preordained from God. But God is able to redeem suffering. He's able to redeem suffering. And sometimes we choose to stand in with others, to empathize, and to stand in solidarity with others through their suffering. And the good news and the reasons why we can do that is because, as the title of our sermon says, death is not the end. The fact that we serve a resurrected Jesus, a Jesus who conquered death, means that we can stand in solidarity with those who are suffering, unafraid, and boldly because we know that death is not the end. Amen?
Amen.
that death is not the end. Even for those, you might even experience this beautiful peace if you've known anybody who's gone through cancer. I had a friend of mine whose mom went through cancer, and there was this beautiful peace about her. She knew she was going to go, she knew she was going to die, but there was this incredible peace about her because she knew that death was not the end, that she was going to live forevermore with Jesus. I think that's the courage and the strength and the boldness that this letter was saying to the Jews who were being persecuted. Hey, guess what? Death is not the end. Remember that you serve a Jesus who resurrected. That we don't serve a God who doesn't have the power over life and death. That verse says that he broke the fear of death. And I just want to take a moment for us to sit there. What kinds of things would we do if we really believed that the fear of death was broken? What sort of ways would we stand out and be bold for Jesus if we knew, if we really believed that the fear of death was broken? I think I was most struck with that. It's like, yeah, let me sit there for a minute. Let me park the car, right? What sort of things would I do if I really believe that? And I think that's the good news of this text, is that we get to live our lives now. The other thing about this text that's so lovely is that we are brothers and sisters in Christ. That with Christ, with Jesus, we are family and we are brothers and sisters, and God is our Heavenly Father. That means that the things that we do for one another is different because we're brothers and sisters, right? The fact that we bought Isaac Laker Knicks tickets, I won't tell you how much they cost, is because he's our son. Because the things that we do for family, for kin, is different. And so, how then we live knowing, how do we live then, understanding fully that, A, the power of death has been broken, and that we are brothers and sisters of Christ. How shall we then live this year? As we serve in this community, as we serve in our jobs, as we recognize others as our brothers and sisters. I think that's the beauty of this text. Almost the power, the encouragement, the kind of like, amen of this text is this thought that death has been conquered and that we are brothers and sisters in Christ.
That's a good word. That's a powerful word. And in addition, during those times, right, those hard decisions or when we're called to live boldly for Jesus, Jesus himself is the one giving us the strength and ability to do so, right? Because he himself underwent it, and he then is empowering us. So in light of this sermon, in light of this text, in light of it being New Year, and some of us are creating New Year's resolutions, Sydney calls them goals, hopes, how then can we live out this text? In light of knowing that Christ himself suffered, not just for himself, but for others. In light of knowing that sometimes we enter into suffering on behalf of others, and knowing that death is not the end of the story, that suffering is not the end of the story, that Christ is right there with us, and he is the end of the story. So in light of all of this, how can we live this text out in 2017? I ask myself that question too. I think about myself personally and how I am a minister. It's what I went to school for. I went to 10 years of school for it to be, in all reality. It's Bible school, Bible college, then seminary, 10 years, a lot of money, a lot of debt. But it's what I felt called to do. And I love studying the scriptures. It's one of the most life-giving things for me. I can sit there and I can read it and think about it, meditate it, read other authors and what they have to say about it. Yeah, I do my best. I can read it in Greek sometimes. as faithful as I can to the gospel, to the reading of scriptures. As I study, as I preach, as I teach, as I share my thoughts on scriptures as a minister, I want to give my uttermost best to doing it. And be as faithful as I can, knowing that sometimes it's not the popular opinion. It's not what everybody agrees with or wants to hear, but it's something, it's a way that I think I can live out this text, knowing that I am doing my best to be faithful and at the same time, even subjecting myself, being vulnerable to even rejection because other people may differ from it. Cindy, how about you? How can you live out this text in 2017?
I think I'm just going to ignore it. Can we just be honest about how difficult this text is to live out sometimes? Part of our discipleship as followers of Jesus is to acknowledge, yeah, this is hard to do. I don't know if you've ever seen that show, What Would You Do? With John Quinones. And they create all these different scenarios of, they kind of set people up to see how people will respond to them. And sometimes there's situations of, like they had a nanny and a young girl, and the young girl was treating the nanny really poorly, just to see if people would step in, and then vice versa. And you wonder, I wonder, like, would I say something? What would I do? And so that this text is a difficult text to live out, A, because if you follow it to its logical conclusion, you to follow Jesus to the point of death. And that's hard. That's not easy. It's kind of scary in some ways. So I think that we all are going to be called and stirred in different ways to follow this text. I think for me is working with my Dreamer students at Fresno Pacific, who are very, very afraid right now, post the election, and who don't feel welcome, similar to what we talked about earlier, a space where you used to always feel welcome, and now you don't feel so welcome. So I want to offer them a place where they feel welcome, they feel loved, they feel accepted, they feel safe, even at the cost of whatever that will mean for me in terms of the university's policies. But to protect them to the point of whatever I need to do. So I think that's how I choose to live up this text. But I want to encourage you that to live, you serve a resurrected Christ. You serve a God who's conquered death, and you are co-heirs in that. And I think that's great news. So why don't we bow our heads and close our eyes, and I just want to pray over you. But as you sit, just in a moment of silence, whatever you hear the Spirit stirring or saying, or God maybe putting something on your heart about a place in which you can stand in solidarity with others. Some of you already do. Some of you, you know, like the Christian Cafe and the Smart Center and the animal shelter, all participate in walking and suffering with others. And so maybe for you, it's just a reaffirmation of what God has called you to do. And for others, maybe there's something that has been stirring for a while, but you've sort of been putting it off because it's hard. God is asking you to do something that's not so trendy or popular or easy. So just take a moment to hear from the Lord. For this reason, he had been made like them, fully human in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service to God.
and that he might make atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. Lord, you were tempted in every way. And so, God, you see us fully and know us fully. May we be able to stand with you and for others throughout this year. Give us the strength to continue to live faithfully to your word and to your call on our lives. Thank you for this church and this congregation and the commitment they've made to serve this place, to serve this community, and to walk with you. We thank you so much, Lord Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Well, if you have not yet made a commitment to follow Jesus, I'm not sure that this sermon necessarily encouraged you to do so, but I would encourage you to do so, to know that we serve a Jesus who is resurrected, has the power to free us from anything. This church has become a home to us, and we have thoroughly loved to be here. And so if you'd like to make a commitment